I'm a nature freak. Some might label me a tree hugger, or a greenie, or even a hippie. The truth is, I love more than just humans. Can we still talk? If we do, we might learn we share this in common. I've been studying culture and how we communicate about the environment and other species for 2 decades. What I've learned is most people in industrialized, westernized cultures tend to not talk about their care for the more than human world. And those rare times they do, they're often labeled and dismissed as a nature nut. In my research, I've observed this dynamic across multiple countries and diverse contexts. One context I study is tourism around wild whales and dolphins. Animals referred to as charismatic megafauna precisely because people are drawn to them. Our connection is so strong that some people's efforts to protect whales include placing their own bodies between them and harpoons. In fact, it was these acts of protection about a half century ago, and around the same time, our first glimpse of the whole planet Earth from outer space, that birthed the contemporary global environmental protection movement. But before we talk about why we still won't talk about our love for whales, I want to share a story about worms. Some years ago, at a university in the US Pacific Northwest, it had been raining heavily, and a student and I were talking about our walks home. After heavy rains in this part of the world, millions of earthworms squeeze up through cracks in city sidewalks. It's thought the worms are taking advantage of the wet surfaces to move across distances otherwise unnavigable. As they stretch their bodies in shiny lines across the concrete, most passersby step on them without notice or care. But the class we just finished was about environment and society. My student brought up the worms, saying that on these rainy days, she took forever to get home, as she'd stop and kneel every time she saw a worm to gently remove them, one by one, from harm's way. Whenever someone walked by, she added, she just pretended she was tying her shoe. This student stood out as someone who was brave and upfront in expressing her truth otherwise. She was a queer firefighter. She confronted prejudices and broke through occupational, gender, and sexuality norms every day. So it was especially striking that, during those worm-saving moments, she found norms of human-centeredness comparatively insurmountable. So she consciously masked her feelings for another species, hiding her actions away every time another person came by. From city sidewalks to places we seek out connections with wildlife, my research has found most people overwhelmingly discipline themselves and each other to be human-centered, or anthropocentric. Think about the last time you hugged a tree or stopped to smell flowers. If you did, and other people were around, you may have felt a little self-conscious. But expressing our inner nature freaks is deeply important for thriving in the 21st century. I'm going to explain what's standing in the way. Once we understand how this happens in our daily lives, we can do something about it. Let's start with who we are. We're all pretty aware of our social and cultural identities, our race, ethnicities, class, genders, sexualities, and so on. However, most of us tend to pay little to no attention to our ecological identities. If we're brought up in industrialized, urbanized, westernized cultures, we're raised to think we are separate from nature. Growing up with a worldview that humans are not nature, we learn to think the environment is out there somewhere, a background for the human drama, a bank of resources, a system of services. It's there to serve us. We're its master. We forget we're earthly, that all the ways we behave have relational and ecological impacts, whether good or bad, from composting to overconsuming, from creating circular economies to stoking unrestrained extraction. This common sense that humans are separate from and better than nature informs the ways we think, talk, and act. And this human centrism has massive effects, from climate crisis to mass extinction. A protest sign familiar in recent years reads, "We need system change, not climate change." many of us understand we must reimagine our political economic systems if we are to tend to the ecological crises these very systems created. However, it may be harder to understand how it's also our dominant cultural systems, our very notions of who we are, that must simultaneously change. It's been some centuries that Enlightenment-informed cultures have separated humans from our earthly constitutions and kin. This disassociation is built into educational and religious institutions, as well as structures of government, law, property, and business. And these systems of separation have been globalized through colonization and the aggressive drive for ever more profit. So what do these systems have to do with my student hiding her saving of worms? While these institutions shape our lives and planet, so do our everyday interactions. Through most of our interactions, we tend to reinforce norms of human centrism. Undoing these norms is culturally and ecologically transformative, but it takes courage. My research traces how human centrism is kept intact through daily communication, from ridiculing, labeling, and silencing others who express more than human care and connection, to doing the very same to ourselves. Where I do much of my research is in the highest concentration of whale tourism in the world, with international tourists coming specifically to see endangered orcas who hunt salmon along the North American Pacific coast. Yet, in this place where people travel far and pay hundreds of dollars to have a chance to see wild orcas, they often make fun of each other when they're a bit too exuberant. For instance, those moments when people ooh and ah, expressing excitement when seeing orcas for the first time, locals jokingly call this the orcagasm. In addition, when tourists speak of their care for whales, they often wait till they're alone to tell me, and even then label themselves as silly or as fanatics or as addicted to whales. Even volunteers I interview who dedicate their hours to monitoring endangered orcas avoid talking about their feelings of profound connection to whales in front of each other, saying they don't want to sound woo-woo or weird. This disciplining is not limited to visitors, but extends to scientists, tourism industry, and activists who cross the anthropocentric line by being a little too into orcas. A common term used to label such enthusiasts is dorkas. Disciplining ourselves and others isn't reserved to connections with whales and worms. Enforcing human-centeredness applies to wild flora, fauna, and of course, to the environment itself. A PhD student studying human relations with wild plants said, "This is going to sound a little crazy, but after learning more about these plants, I feel different when I'm walking in the hills. I no longer feel alone. I know this sounds kind of out there, but now I feel like I'm with friends." We know expressing connection or kinship with nature in Westernized societies sounds out there. That's because we know, subconsciously, there's a clear cultural line drawn between humans and nature. And we know when we've crossed that line. Scientists drawn to biology or ecology, by their love for other animals or ecosystems, know they need to abide by research writing norms that refer to non-human animals as it instead of he, she, or them. Environmental activists know to emphasize the language of developers and government and discuss nature in instrumental terms. We all know nature freaks or people who are out there don't get heard and certainly don't get taken seriously. But this human centrism, perpetuated through cultural and institutional systems, is killing us and bringing much of life on Earth down with us, whether we acknowledge we're connected to that life or not. As a social force, our interactions are also a force for transformation, for changing what's normal, what's possible, for enlivening us and our convivial relations with our planet. The opposite of anthropocentrism is ecocentrism. Okay, we're going to be boundary crossing for a moment. Forget temporarily the ridicule and the labels that hold us back. Ecocentrism is a belief that humans are not the center of life, but instead are one species among multitudes that form the network of relationships of mutual planetary existence. Ecocentrism draws attention then to how we relate within this living network, to the importance of being aware, humble, and responsible ecological kin. Ecocentrism may sound familiar. It's a way of knowing, talking, and acting that's helped humans thrive along with related ecosystems for millennia. And sacred forms of ecocentrism have survived colonialism with an enduring indigenous systems of knowledge around the world. In Western cultures, ecocentrism survived in pockets. At the heart of the Romantic movement, reacting against early industrialization and urbanization, and as a driver of past and present environmental activisms. But how can more people be ecocentric in Westernized and industrialized cultures and settings? How do we overcome the ridicule, labeling, and silencing that upholds human centrism? I'm going to share three successful techniques I've observed in my research. Number one, break the bonds. Call foul, flip the script, doggedly refuse to be disciplined. By refusing to stick within the bounds, you stay on your toes, and you're always ready to consciously take part in negotiating what's acceptable, what is a norm, and in the process, to relocate culture. We are seeing this happen. For instance, we've gone from decades of vegetarians being labeled weird or questionable to it now becoming common sense, even aspirational. World City Michelin-starred restaurants are making headlines, changing to 100% plant-based menus, and star athletes promote their all-vegan diets. Number two, change with others. It's easier to break through boundaries and embrace other ways of being when you do it with others. It's also more fun. Acting ecocentric together, even just for a short time, can inform entirely different ways of being. For example, if you feel self-conscious picking up rubbish on your own, join a community cleanup event to cheer you on. If your efforts to green your workplace are frustrated, gather a committee of companions to normalize the change. If you falter when trying to talk climate crisis, volunteer with a group like Climate for Change to bolster your courage and effect. Number three, be vulnerable. Years after my student told me she pretended to tie her shoe instead of letting others see she was helping worms, I was walking with another student across another campus. It was a hot day with blasting sun. On the concrete path, I noticed a thin, wriggling worm folding onto itself, trying to find shelter. I knelt and gently placed the worm on a patch of shaded soil. Standing above me, I heard my student say in a cynical tone that seemed to surprise us both, "Saving a life, huh?" As the earthworm found a way back into the safety of the soil, the chastening force of the student's comment settled onto us. To sustain life, we need to be responsive to the vulnerability of species, peoples, ecosystems, and atmospheres. And we need to be in touch with our own vulnerability. So, when it comes to breaking bonds of human centrism, think of your words as wire cutters. Don't hold back. Be part of the change and accelerate the change. Now is the time to let your nature freak flag fly.